Hey friends, this is our second installment in the Bible study we're doing on the book of Acts as we are in this time of isolation from each other, but we are still in a time where we can study and grow our faith. And so today we're looking at the second chapter of Acts, verses 1 through 42. This is the story of Pentecost. And you can pause here if you want to get a Bible or get the scripture in front of you. I'm going to be reading specifically verses 2 through 14, but we're really talking about that whole chunk of scripture. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like a rush of a violent wind. It filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. There were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. At this sound, the crowd gathered. They were bewildered because each one of them heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, visitors from Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." So all were amazed and perplexed, said to one another, "What does this mean?" Others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine, that they're drunk." Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say." And then after that, Peter goes into what is the first recorded sermon of the apostles after Christ is resurrected, and it's up to them to carry on the church. So the time of Pentecost, it's this reaffirmation of the promises Jesus made to the disciples and to us, that we would not be left alone. Wind of Spirit descends and rests with something that looks like tongues of fire on them. And there are some obvious echoes here back to Genesis, when God's Spirit, God's wind, was hovering over the face of the water. In the days of the Old Testament prophets, the Spirit would empower a prophet who would speak for God. The Spirit was particular, if you like, that the empowering was rare. And before Jesus, for several hundred years, it had been said in the Jewish community that God had stopped even raising up prophets. So what's unique about Pentecost is that on this day, the Holy Spirit is unleashed, and it fills and empowers all. So who was there? These devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. And it goes through this list of Elamites and Medes who would have lived over in Mesopotamia, and Pontus and Cappadocia, which would have been the Mediterranean, Asia Minor, what we know as Greece, Egypt to the south, Rome to the far west. This is far more than geography. It is the symbolism of the breadth of what God is about to do. There's a writer named Willie Jennings who describes this whole section of Acts as the sound of intimacy. And what he means by that is there's new wine that's been poured out on those unaware of just how deeply they were thirsting. A revolution of the intimate is going to be occurring, this beginning of a new communal and cultural boundary-breaking activity by the sheer act of God. So God takes hold of tongue and voice, body and mind. It's the Spirit's act of joining. So to speak a language is to speak a people. Speaking announces familiarity, connection, relation, understanding. There is a miracle of hearing that takes place. So God reveals a mighty hand and an outstretched arm that reaches deep into the lives of Jesus' co-travelers and pushes them along this new road into these places that God seeks to be more fully known. Now, learning a language takes patience, submission, falling in love with the sounds, and it's not an overstatement to say that language can be a sharp tool, a vehicle for understanding, but also, regrettably, for conquering. We only need to look back at the history of colonial conquests that forced indigenous cultures into submission, forced them to learn a new language, not by choice, but so that they could be more easily controlled. And Christian empires have a laundry list of having practiced this for thousands of years. But thankfully, there are some stories that quietly survived. There were some missionaries who practiced differently. They would travel to a new land to be changed. They sought to learn the natural local language and to find another voice, another speech, another way of life. They were there to be changed, not just to change people into believers. They were there not to make conquered Christians, but to truly and deeply make themselves more Christian in a new space. So as these multiple voices are being raised in this Acts chapter, there is skepticism. The miraculous communication evokes this question in verse 12. What does this mean? The response from one of the disciples was going to be necessary, and surprisingly, it's Peter. There are fresh memories of Peter's failures around this time. The same Peter who weeks before was afraid to speak to a servant girl. The same Peter who denied Jesus three times. The same Peter whose failures led him to weep bitterly. Where does he find the power now to get up and speak? It is through the Holy Spirit. So the sermon itself is evidence of the Spirit's power to transform a person. Theologian Will Willimon says, "The Spirit has breathed life into a once cowardly disciple and created a new man who now has the gift of bold speech." So this sermon by Peter is the first of many speeches that not only he, but many of the disciples are going to make in the book of Acts as they boldly witness their faith in Jesus in all sorts of circumstances, in front of all sorts of political power and oppression. Willimon again says, "The Spirit is the power which enables the church to go public with its good news and to attract a crowd, to have something to say worth hearing." So the Holy Spirit gives them the courage to speak and share the word, and it's been that way ever since. Since Pentecost, believers have told and retold the story of Jesus. By the Spirit's power, we think about everything in a new way. Writer Willie Jennings says, "The same Spirit, there from the beginning, hovering, brooding in the joy of creation of the universe and of each one of us, who knows us together and separately in our most intimate places, has announced the divine intention through the Son to reach into our lives and make each life a sight of speaking glory. This will require bodies that reach across massive and real boundaries, cultural, religious, and ethnic." So this is serious stuff, but it is cause for celebration. This Holy Spirit, once unleashed, cannot be tamed, controlled, or planned. And we ask the question, where will it take us and into whose lives? Do we hear what the tongues mean? For this, we don't need interpreters, we need translators. People who are willing to allow their lives to be translated, not just once, but again and again, as the Spirit gives utterance. So I invite you to think about that this Lenten season, friends. The closing prayer I want to do comes from a book by Ted Loader called Gorillas of Grace. Some of the best written prayers I've ever come across, and this is one for us in our season of Lent. Let us pray. Catch me in my mindless scurrying, Lord, and hold me in this Lenten season. Hold my spirit to the beacon of your grace and grant me light enough to walk boldly, to feel passionately, to love aggressively. Grant me peace enough to want more, to work for more, and to submit to nothing less, and to fear only you. Bequeath me not becalmed seas, slack sails, and premature benedictions, but breathe into me a torment, storm enough to make within myself and from myself something, something new, something saving, something true, a gladness of heart, a pitch for a song in the storm, a word of praise lived, a gratitude shared, a cross dared, a joy received. Amen.